coming up at 8:25. We're back here inside the Beatsy Kitchen. Perfect track to get us in the mood here. Lisa Bolton, brand new book, On Boards. See what you did there, Lisa. How to get the perfect cheese plate, the charcuterie laid out. This is artwork right
Thank
there.
Thank you. This is our fall sort of harvest-inspired board, so we're really kind of pulling on the colors fall and a lot of seasonal fruits in here for fun. So, yeah, this is a fun one for this time of year.
Sure. Nice one to show off at the party, but yes. How do we get to this point is the question if we're going to have a cheese board.
Yeah, so we're going to build one today.
Okay. How do you choose which cheeses make the cut to put on the board in the first place?
Well, I love a star, so you have, like, pick one killer cheese. Like, okay. I think you go invest in something like this. We have a Syrah-soaked Tuscanet here, real favorite. And then you can kind of put in some other crowd-friendly ones. So an easy brie. This is a nice goat cheese. So I think you have a killer one, and then you can accentuate that.
Okay, your MVP cheese again was?
It's a Syrah-soaked, so a wine-soaked Toscana. So it's like an older cheddar, super flavorful. Goes with great with a glass of wine.
Fancy.
Love it.
Okay, so cheeses are laid out. Usually about three cheeses?
About three. I like to start with the big items. So when I'm putting a board together, I kind of anchor it with like my three cheeses and my grapes. Grapes are a great contrast when you're having a lot of fatty sort of charcuterie or rich creamy cheeses. Grapes are like a nice way to cleanse your palate.
Okay.
And then we're just kind of going to go in and lay in some crackers. There's not a, you know, rhyme or reason. I sort of, after doing literally hundreds, I found that I kind of a bit of a process that I go through.
Okay. The base here, the board is really nice.
Thank you.
How do you choose the board you're going to use?
So I'm partial to wood. I think, you know, a nice, like a dark wood looks really nice with the lighter cheeses, but marble is another way to go. Nice and cool. Keeps things cool longer. And slate's another one that I like to use as a board. So you can actually write on it with chalk if you want to kind of write the names of the cheeses that are on there. So,
okay.
Yeah. So don't be afraid to style outside your board as well. So I don't mind if things kind of come off the edges. And I've also done that here with some of the leaves. So we're just going to tuck some of these over here.
Now, what are some of the faux pas that people are making with these boards?
Not putting enough on them. I love a full board. I love where your eyes are kind of distracted by sort of what's next and where do I look next. So that's sort of my thing. It's like, don't be afraid to fill it up. People will find their way.
Now, like, how many people would this board feed?
You know what? Right, it depends on what the role of the board is. So if this is dinner, this might feed a nice, you know, you're having a couple over. It might be a nice night to do that. But if you're having, you know, a sort of part of an ensemble, so you're doing a potluck, you might have this with a whole bunch of other things, and then it would feed 10 to 12 people.
Okay.
I think I look at who's in my audience. So do I have a lot of vegetarians? Do, you know, I have, I don't know, like some, it's like a game day, like hockey game, and we're going to do like a real sort of, I don't know, afternoon munchies kind of thing. I might beef it up a little bit.
Okay, and you've got the meats coming in.
Yeah.
Your meat selections to complement what's happening.
Totally. So what I like to do is, you know, when you get the meat from the butcher, it's often laid flat. So I really encourage people to kind of drape it on, like take the time to sort of lay it, and you're going to get some nice height and some movement. And even with the salami, as opposed to laying it flat, I'm actually folding it into just two little folds to make a little rose almost. And then we're just going to tuck those in the little corners of places so that they just kind of stay put.
And then the final garnish that
yes.
we put on.
Most, I find that it's like accessorizing an outfit. You definitely want to take the time to put some greenery on.
So Deb pointed, this is like the pocket square of your cheese board right here.
Right.
Right, Deb? That's a good call.
I love it. I've got some like nuts and stuff here if you want to dress up, break up any of the whites. I find if things look a little white, this is just some crushed nuts. It's going to give a little flavor to your goat cheese in here.
And then I see some berries here. How do you worry about staining the board with the berries?
You know what? If you do stain your board, it comes out really nice with coarse salt and a lemon. You can kind of scrub it and it'll come it off. I love anything on a stick, so I quite often will skewer berries and kind of finish a board with them that way.
Yeah.
We've got something. And I've got some colorful carrots here. So leave your tops on your vegetables. I think that's a really nice way to kind of give a bit of a handle. Got some color here.
Look at this.
We're going to tuck those in over there. Starting to come together. And then, like I said, we're always going to finish with a bit of greenery and nuts. Nuts are really nice.
Beautiful. Well, again, the book is called On Boards. You can pick it up. Lots of ideas, especially going into the holiday season. And I just want to point this out because I said, this is my biggest pet peeve with cheese boards. People just get their grubby fingers in here. Baby tongs. Baby tongs right there. Everything is safe. Hygiene, always important in the holidays. Lisa, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Now we get to eat.
We get to eat.
This is my attempt at a segue as a hoarding squirrel in Edmonton taking the city.
Well, I add the nuts.
By storm, yes. It's a good thing that squirrel's not here. Check her out on Insta.